So recently there was an incident in JNU in Delhi where a group, or let's say a gang of almost 50 people, masked, armed with lathis and iron rods and dangerous weapons, they entered the campus, smashed the property, including the hostels, assaulted people and caused very severe injuries. And after that, they escaped. Now, here's a question. This happened in Delhi, in JNU, right? And I'm not looking at the... So let's for a moment put aside the political aspects, right? Let's just ask from the point of view of law and order, right? How could this happen? Now, the question is, if you put yourself in the shoes of the guys who committed the offense, they clearly did not have the fear. If they had the fear that, you know, if we do this, there will be some immediate consequences, then they would probably not have done that. So the question is, what should they have been afraid of and why were they not afraid? So I would say broadly, there are two things that they should have been afraid of. So one is that since they went together as a gang, so it wasn't like one single guy going somewhere quietly. And second, it was done not like 2 a.m. in the morning. It was done sort of in broad daylight, right? At least in the evening. So the question is, why did they, should they have been afraid of something, of police action? Could the police have taken action? And if so, then you know, why did not? So legally, if you have, let's say, a person who's armed with a weapon and there are, let's say, 3 or 5 or 10 or 20 of them moving together, then I think there is a reasonable apprehension that these people are going to commit an offense. Now, under the law, even CRPC has got a very, very simple provision, which is section 151 of CRPC, as per which any policeman or any police officer can arrest a person without any warrant, without any order from the court, if he believes that this person is likely to commit an offense, a cognizable offense, and they feel that there is no other way to stop them. So which means that if a cop had seen these guys, legally, he had the authority to arrest them without any further orders or any warrant from a court. Second thing is that these guys, they did not move around. They were not going it wasn't one guy. It was a big gang. Now, when you have more than 5 people, it becomes an unlawful assembly. If you are armed and if you are likely to commit an offense, then that itself is a crime. So which means, like any other riotous mob, police could have, if they had crossed a police force, they could have been dispersed, they could have been asked to either disperse or they could have been arrested, and they could have faced lathi charge or any consequence like that. Now the question is, clearly these guys did not, they were at least, you know, they knew that this would not happen. So why is that? Now, I'm not saying that Delhi police was compromised or they would not take action. That's not my claim. But my claim is that there is a very high probability that the guys who committed the offense, the perpetrators, they did not have the fear of police. Now, why is that? Now, the fact is that in India, unlike a country like, let's say, the US, where rule of law is very, very strong, in India, our rule of law is very weak. And one of the core reasons for that is police is completely under the control of the local government. So in states, the state government controls the police. And in Union Territory, in Delhi, it is under the control of the central government. Number one. Number two, we have a culture where political parties think of, when they are the ruling party, they think of police as an extension of their party. So they think that, you know, they own the police, which very sadly, in some cases, turns out to be sort of true, because a lot of police officers, they behave as if they are owned by the ruling party or the government. Why does that happen? Again, I'm not going to give a long answer, but the very simple fact is that a police officer can be, the government wants, they can put him in a very, very important position where they have a lot of responsibility and they have authority, or they can put them in a position where they have absolutely no role, no meaningful role at all. So if I can make somebody, you know, I can take him from being like a, feeling like, you know, he's a really powerful guy and make him nothing, then I have the control over the guy. And that is the power which the governments use to keep the police under their control. And that is why over time, the strength of the police forces, it has corroded. And if you go down at the police station level, a sub-inspector or a constable, many of them, they in Delhi, I'm pretty sure this would be the case. Like a lot of people, they do not have the confidence that if I take this action, right, what will be, even if I do the right thing, will the consequence be good for me? Not sure. They're not sure. Why is that? For the same action, one day this guy can be commended and another day he can be suspended. I have seen this. So this is, I'm not making it up. This is something which is not at all unheard of. It is a fairly common thing. Another point I want to make is that when a police officer takes action, obviously we have to hold them accountable. They have to act as per law. But if they have taken action as per the law, as per the standard operating procedures, or as per the what is a reasonable norm, they should not have to worry about their own safety, about the consequences. But in India, that is not the case. So as a result, a lot of policemen, police officers at the junior level, they are very scared. They will not act unless they get some distinct order from the top. And these perpetrators, they probably know that. They know that, okay, you know, these guys will not act against us. Now, why would that be the case? I do not have the facts. I can only speculate. So we know that all the guys who were injured, they were from the left-leaning students' unions. So which means there is a high probability. Again, we do not know for sure. The investigation has to find out. But there's a high probability that the perpetrators were from the opposite side, and they may have had the conviction that, you know, police is not going to act against us. So this is one big area that, you know, before they took action, they could have been arrested, they could have been dispersed using force, and the whole thing could have been stopped. But they still went ahead, and because they probably knew that this won't happen. This second thing that they should have been worried about is that once they, let's say, you know, nobody saw them and they entered the campus and did whatever they did, they should have the fear of, after that, you know, there'll be a trial, they'll be arrested, and there'll be a conviction. If they get convicted, they spend maybe 6 months, 1 year in jail, and this, it would, you know, badly affect their career. But then clearly that fear is not there. Why is that? Again, here, sad fact. In India, almost all rioting cases end in acquittal. I'll say it again. In India, almost all rioting cases, I would argue 99+%, I'm pretty sure it is more than 99.5, 99.8, whatever, but a very large percentage of rioting cases, they do not end in conviction, which means there's no consequence. Why is that? Now, again, there are various reasons. I'll not get into a lot of detail, but the fact is, to convict a rioting case, you need a lot of evidence. Very, very hard to get evidence. You have to prove there was a crowd. This person was member of the crowd. He had the same objective as the crowd, and somebody has to, there has to be some means to identify him. And those things are very, very hard to do. Another fact is that a lot of rioting cases, the government of the day quietly withdraws them after some time. And finally, the most important thing, even if, let's say, the case is charge sheeted, when will it come for trial? 3 months, 6 months, 1 year, 2 years, 3 years, 5 years? We don't know. It could take 7 years, could it take 10 years. By the time the witnesses are, nobody's interested, the case is over. If the guys, let me tell you one thing, if the guys knew that, okay, we can go and do this, but within 3 months, within 6 months, we will end up going to jail, number one. Number two, we will end up spending, let's say, 6 months in jail. We don't have to have life very long prison terms, doesn't matter. If there was a certainty that, okay, you do this and you will spend 3 months in jail, I can tell you how many people would have showed up for this. Zero. Guaranteed. Right? So this is the sad part. I do not have a ready solution for this. I think it's a combination of improving the investigation process, and we have to improve the, we have to change the way police is treated and the police runs in this country. But the fact is, unless we address and change these things, we cannot be a rule of law country. In the US, you can be the president, you can be a senator, it doesn't matter. Right? If you are accused of a crime, you will pretty much get the same end of the stick as everybody else. In India, it's not the case. That is something that we have to change. And unless we change that, these kind of things will keep happening, sadly. Thank you for watching.